The letter of James clearly ascribes its own authorship to a figure called James. Everybody, I think, agrees more or less now that this James was the James who was the brother of Jesus, who was the leader of the Jerusalem church for much of its history. And the reason for that is partly simply that he was the one person in the early church whom you could call James and be confident people would know which James you were talking about, because there were quite a few leaders of early Christian movement who were called James. So the work is ascribed to James. Did he really write it, or was it a case of pseudepigraphy? A large part of the scholarly tradition in recent times has disputed that it was written by James, but I think in fact the tide is turning, and it's hard to find really solid reasons anymore for supposing it not to have been written by James himself. Remember that James was head of the Jerusalem church, which in the period up to AD 70, when it existed, the Jerusalem church was the mother church of the whole Christian movement, would be in constant touch with the rest of the Christian movement, and particularly for Jewish Christians who would continue to make pilgrimage to the temple and encounter the Jerusalem church in that context. So it makes a lot of sense, I think, to regard James as a letter written from Jerusalem to, and this is what the first verse of the letter tells us, to the 12 tribes in the dispersion. So John is writing for Jewish Christians primarily, scattered throughout the Jewish diaspora, that is across all the Roman Empire, and probably also to the east through Babylonia and so on, where the Jewish diaspora was just as important as the Western diaspora. So he's writing for this very broad audience, and what I think we should think of the letter as is a compendium of James's wisdom. It's not, I think, addressing any specific problems or issues that have come up here or there. It's really a resource for Christians to turn to educate themselves in early Christian faith, and particularly issues of lifestyle. And you can see that James is full of little aphorisms, these pungent little sayings that sum up a whole issue. And those, I think, are meant for memorization and pondering and reflection. So it wasn't written, I think, as an argument to be read through from beginning to end. It's more of a miscellany of material on different subjects, much of which had probably been developed by James for his teaching before he wrote the letter, and he's bringing it together as a kind of handy compendium of material. Well, ever since Martin Luther called the letter of James an epistle of straw and was quite dubious about whether it should be in the canon of the New Testament, I think James has been saddled with something of a dubious reputation. Especially because, of course, the dominant movement in biblical scholarship until fairly recently was German Lutheran. So this problem about James, and the problem that Luther saw with James, I think, was simply that James appears to contradict Paul on the issue that was at the heart of Luther's Reformation, the issue of justification by faith alone. Paul, of course, says that we're justified by faith. James says, quite specifically, we are not justified by faith alone, but by works. And it's quite easy to read those as in straight contradiction. And I think the apparent contradiction with Paul may also be why James was one of the last books to get generally accepted in the early church as part of the New Testament scriptures. Because Paul was accepted, it's quite difficult to bring in something alongside Paul that looks so different. But we need to read both James and Paul in their own context. And particularly, we need to read James for his own sake before we start comparing him with Paul. And I think another problem with study of James has been, as it were, reading James from a Pauline perspective, rather than giving James a chance to speak for himself, as it were. What does James mean when he says someone is not justified by faith alone? but by works. He's regarding faith there. Something else that James says is, you believe, so what? The demons also believe. So it seems that what he means by belief there, or faith, is simply intellectual assent. The demons know that God exists, but it has no result, doesn't make them any more obedient to God. And James, I think, is saying that believing in God and in Jesus Christ is of no value unless it issues in good works, the kinds of things that James commends throughout his letter as the way in which Christians should be living. Clearly, if one takes that view, mere intellectual belief is not the basis of justification of being put right with God. When we turn to Paul, it's quite clear that Paul has a much fuller understanding of what faith is. For Paul, faith is wholehearted trust in God, the sort of trust in God that will result in a different way of living. And I think Paul would say, in fact, Paul does say on one occasion, faith working through love. He takes it for granted that the two go together. And the faith he's talking about is a long way from mere intellectual assent. So you need to actually define the terms they're both using in their own terms, rather than importing one into the other or vice versa. So I think it turns out that Paul and James are addressing different circumstances. James is concerned with people who profess faith but don't do anything about it. Paul is concerned with people who say, well, you've got to do these Jewish things like keeping Sabbath and being circumcised in order to be a member of the people of God. They're addressing very, very different circumstances, and so it's not surprising that they come out with rather different statements in different terms. James is a wisdom document. In other words, the style in which he teaches is that of the Jewish wisdom tradition, going back to the book of Proverbs in the Old Testament and other Jewish literature of that sort. What distinguishes James's sort of wisdom, and here I think he's at one with Jesus' sort of wisdom, is that it's a countercultural kind of wisdom. It doesn't tell people how to live comfortably within the structures of society that exist. It tells people how to live differently. So John characteristically, James characteristically, but very like John, has this contrast between God and the world. James's readers are to keep themselves unstained by the world. And you cannot be a friend of God and a friend of the world. Rather, like Jesus, you can't serve God and mammon. So James actually sets up this really quite strong contrast between God's values and those of the world, by which he means, of course, not the physical world, nor world of human beings as such, but the kind of culture, the values that are around in the dominant culture of his day. So if we think of James as propounding an understanding of Christian lifestyle, that's really what he's mainly writing about, lifestyle, a kind of understanding of lifestyle that may well be in sharp contrast to what's going on in society around. Can we make any sense of James as countercultural for our own society? And of course the issues might be different, but are the issues that James is concerned with relevant to the Christian community in our society? I think one of the obvious features of our society with which James would have been extremely unhappy, I think, is consumerism. Because one of the strong themes of James's letter is about wealth and poverty, about the way God chooses the poor to be